You may like to gamble, you might like to dance. You may be the heavyweight champion of the world. You may be a socialite with a long string of pearls, but you're gonna have to serve somebody. Yes, indeed, you're gonna have to serve somebody. Well, it may be the devil or it may be the Lord, but you're gonna have to serve somebody.
Thank you for joining us today on Something to Think About with Pastor Mike, where the topics can range from current events, historical perspectives, practical Bible application, to whatever's on his mind today. People have stereotypes of what it means to be a Christian, and one thing's for sure, Pastor Mike loves breaking those stereotypes. Pastor Mike Hasseltine is the senior pastor of Maranatha Church with campuses in Forest Lake and Chisago, Minnesota. With over 40 years of practical pastoral ministry, Pastor Mike challenges us to be real people, loving a real God, right in the midst of all our real lives. Now, here's Pastor Mike.
Hey, good morning. It's just so good to be here once again. Fridays, they just keep popping up. You know, I was listening to the intro again, and you talk about, hey, you can talk about whatever's on his mind. Sometimes that's a scary thing. You just never know. What is on his mind today? I like the idea that we just get to ramble and pontificate on whatever we want to do it.
That's a $5 word.
Pontificate. Yeah, pontificate, yes.
So what's your goal for today? I shall pontificate.
You know, I do a lot of pontificating. When I was having some voice issues, they found out what I did for a living, and they go, oh, so you just can't, like, not talk. And I no, not really. I talk all the time to, you know, groups and people and whatever, talk all the time. Mm-hmm. So it's great. And, hey, I want to welcome our producers over there. It's like, man, thanks, guys. It's good to see Jenny.
Good to be here. Yes.
Our station manager is actually sitting in. I'm not sure if she's here to babysit me, watch me pontificate, and worried about what I'm going to pontificate on. I'm not sure. We have, you know, Gary, our major engineer, the guy that keeps everything going. The hamster and wheel just keeps on running.
He is incredible.
Yeah, and then we have one of our producers, Jay, over there. He does not have a microphone at the moment.
He can speak into this.
I might not want to.
Too late.
Oh, man. You know, we just have way too much fun together. We do. Which is kind of a main theme of my life. If you ain't having fun, ain't nobody else having fun around you.
That's true.
I don't understand why people don't just smile and try to make lemonade when they get lemons. Again, I don't seem insensitive. There are painful things in life and time to grieve and all that. But for the majority of time, you know, I've asked people, when you wake up in the morning, do you say, good Lord, it's morning? Or do you say, good morning, Lord?
Amen.
That's a big difference.
It is a super difference.
Yeah. Pastor Robin, how are you today?
I'm really good.
Fantastic.
I am. I've got some really cool national days for today. Are you ready to hear?
Let's see. Maybe.
Okay. Maybe.
Some of these things always just really surprise me because they're so weird and bizarre. They're national recognition days.
Right. And what I don't know is if somebody just pulled this idea out of their hat, but regardless. Okay. So here they go. Banana Day, Bicycle Day, Congenital Diaphragmic Hernia Action Day. So for all of you who have congenital diaphragmic hernias, today's your day to do something about that.
Is it the day to do something about it or celebrate it?
It says Action Day.
Woo!
I don't know. I mean, I think those need care. Dutch American Friendship Day. So congratulations to all the Dutch Americans and that they have friends. Woo! Okay, Humorous Day, National Amaretto Day. National Cat Lady Day.
Cat Lady Day?
National Cat Lady Day.
Okay, we're just a quick second. National Cat Lady Day.
Yeah.
I'm kind of curious, is there a Cat Man Day?
Right. I mean, how...
Makes you wonder, doesn't it?
Well, not really, but there's lots of fellas out there
that
love cats.
I remember when I was younger, there was a cat woman on TV. I thought she was pretty... It was like kind of intriguing.
Oh, you're talking about...
Batman. That's right. And Catwoman.
Who was that?
Yeah, the Catwoman.
Ursula Andress.
Not like a cat lady, but a Catwoman.
She had quite the amazing suit and attitude to go with it as well. Okay, so let's go on.
Let's go on.
National Dog Parent Appreciation Day.
Dog parent? There is no such thing as a dog parent.
So
There's no, you know, I have
somebody
to admit,
thinks so.
Oh man, you know, dogs, they're pets, they're animals. I'm gonna go down this road, and I know I'm gonna bother some people. But you know something? So one day, this is funny. So we have a dog, and we're out walking, and somebody referred to Orlean as, you know, a pet mom. You're the dog. She looked at her without missing a beat. She says, "I did not give birth to this thing. I am not its mother." Mm. Hello, wake up, people! You know, it's like, my gosh, you're owner of a pet. You're the caretaker of a pet. You are not the pet parent.
It's a different philosophical approach.
We need a national day for this.
Okay, so there's also, now this would be like my everyday. It's National Garlic Day.
Oh, you like garlic?
Oh my gosh. Garlic, more garlic. Thanks.
And I heard that garlic's good for you.
It is good for you. Does it make you short? It doesn't make you short.
Because you've eaten a lot of it and you're short.
I know. I think those are just coincidental. Although I think it's off-putting to friends, but it's, anyway, National Garlic Day. National Hanging Out Day.
Oh, no, I like that.
Isn't that fun? That sounds like the guys out at our wood shop. They've got a hangout.
Every Thursday is the hangout. We just call it the hangout.
The hangout.
What do you do out there? Well, we're hanging out. People show up and they go, "What do you do?" Well, we're hanging out.
Mm-hmm.
And we call it hangout night, Thursday.
Don't you love it when people call things like what it is?
What it really is.
That's
like,
what
yeah,
it is.
Don't try to make it something different. It's we hang out.
We hang out.
Every Thursday.
That's very
and
cool.
And we have, in the wintertime, we have chili. And in the summertime, we have brats, and we've already made that switch over. We just hang out. We have brats and chips and goodies, cookies.
Cool.
It's cool.
Sounds like a lot of fun for the guys. It's also National Oklahoma City Bombing Commemoration Day.
No, that's a worthy national day.
It is a worthy national day.
That was a tragedy.
Day. It was.
That was a tragedy. You know, people can disagree with a lot of things, but you don't take it to extremes and go blow people up.
Mm-hmm.
Because they won't listen.
Right.
Oh,
right.
My gosh.
Right. National Poker Day.
National Poker Day.
For those who like to play poker. And, you know, here's another food one. So, Rice Ball Day. And if you've not had a good rice ball, man, you are missing out. It's Sylvester the Cat's birthday.
Okay, we got to go back just a minute. I'm looking through the window, and the guys across the light there, you know, the producer and our station manager, they're changing the National Poker Day for me to poke. Like you take your finger and you poke somebody,
and you
irritate and you poke them.
Oh, that's like, a theme in your life.
So they're saying, yeah, it's
poke her.
Yeah.
Poke her. So poke her.
Poke her. Just, yeah, like it's, you know, I do that to Robin all the time. I'm constantly poking people around me in my world. I mean, if they're around my world, I'm constantly trying to teach, jab, make a point, irritate, knock off center, make people, oh, God, what an idea. Something to think about.
Right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
The name of the show. Something to think about.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty well. Okay, so continue.
Almost done. So Sylvester the Cat's birthday.
Sylvester the Cat. The
you remember him?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
The cartoon.
Right.
The character. He has a birthday.
Evidently.
Wow.
I know. And
Who knew?
And last but not least is Poetry and Creative Mind Day.
Poetry and Creative Mind. Well, I like the creativity thing. I like poetry too.
Mm.
I think poetry does things for your mind and your emotions.
Mm-hmm.
If you can sit and enjoy some poetry, it's good. But the idea of creativity, God, I'll tell you what, let's use that as a springboard into what we've started talking about last week,
mm-hmm.
and that is at Maranatha here, what are some of our core values?
Mm-hmm.
And one of them is creativity.
Okay, quick recap. What
yes.
were they last week?
Okay, so we value uniqueness.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so many people think that unity is being the same. And Christians, way too often, they fight for the idea that we can only have fellowship if we agree on everything and we're the same. And that is not true. There is a wonderful thing that happens when we can embrace people that are unique, mm-hmm. different than us.
Mm-hmm.
So we value this idea of uniqueness. And then secondly, we value people being real. That's a whole
mm-hmm.
concept that even when I say it, I can get on a roll and just go down this idea of, man, don't be a Pharisee.
Right.
Don't be a phony. Don't be a hypocrite.
Mm-hmm.
Be true to who you are.
Well, and there have been a number of shows that you've done about don't be a Pharisee, don't be a legalist. So, if anybody wants to hear more about what you think about that, we do happen to have an archive they can go to and enjoy.
Go back and take a listen. Mm-hmm. And by the way, we should just emphasize that you know, our church website is realchurch.org. Mm-hmm. If you want to listen to any Sunday sermons or Wednesdays or podcasts, and we got some very creative, gifted people around here, that their material is on there as well. Facebook is Maranatha Church Forest Lake, and Instagram, Maranatha Church Minnesota. Mm-hmm. But to the radio station here, if somebody wants to make a comment, and even live, if you want to send in a comment right now, man, we'll be able to get it. And that is, the web is yourliferadio.com, but if you want to email us, it's wajc@yourliferadio.com. Mm-hmm. Again, wajc@yourliferadio.com.
They could also, if you wanted to, pop a question over on Facebook. And if you search up 88.1 WAJC Radio, you'll find us there. So that's also another spot you can shoot a comment or a note.
Yeah, it'd be good to hear from you. So uniqueness. We value uniqueness. We value being real. We value being relevant. You know, church, the gospel message has not changed, but how we communicate it does. Mm-hmm. You know, being just relevant, not revelant. Relevant.
There you go.
I need another cup of coffee. Okay, so what's new? We value this idea of creativity. Jesus, I think about, we love Jesus and we just have our own images and ideas of who he is and what he would do. But if you really look at some of the things he did, he was incredibly creative. He broke the mold. He knocked people off their stereotypes. You know, he picked grain on a Sabbath. He healed on the Sabbath. And this idea of being creative, and I think sometimes it's just, I think you got to be creative to make people think. Mm-hmm. Wake them up, knock them out of their habitual patterns. Mm-hmm. You know, why do you do that? Well, you know, that old illustration of the meatloaf. You know, the woman cutting off the ends before she puts it in the thing, and mm-hmm. her husband asks her, why do you do that? Well, because my mom did it. Mm-hmm. And so finally he asks his mom, his wife, what do you, why, you know, your daughter always does this. Well, why did you do it? Oh, she said, that's simple. Because the pan that I put it in was too small. Mm-hmm. I always had to cut the ends off. Mm-hmm. And so we end up doing things, and we don't even know why we do them. So Jesus is walking along, and I'm thinking that he really shocked some people. Cast demons out of people with just a word sometimes.
Right.
He just spoke the word, commanded the demon to leave. He taught using parables of agriculture and accounting. He was this guy that did that. But also, he was a guy who made a whip. It was intentional. Mm-hmm. He gave forethought to it. Mm-hmm. It wasn't a spur-of-the-moment kind of a deal. He made a whip and went in and turned over the money changers' tables. He said to one guy who was blind, he said, be healed, receive your sight. And boom, he received his sight. And then another time, a guy is blind, he spits in the dirt and then puts the mud on the guy's eyes.
Right.
Which brings up a couple questions. How much spit did he have to make mud? Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, was it really mud or was it just described it as mud? Was it dirt? And then secondly, good thing the guy was blind because he wouldn't have probably allowed him to put mud in his eyes.
Yeah, who knows? I mean, you know, probably when he was hawking up, he figured out what he was doing. But.
Oh, man. Yes. Just to be creative, I think... You know, we do an annual bike blessing here. Mm-hmm. 1,000 motorcycles last year drove through the lobby of our church. 4 lines at one time, always just constantly moving, going through, stopping in the middle of the lobby, getting prayed for, then they drive out the back. And by the way, folks listening, that's June 2nd this year.
Mm-hmm. Come, yeah.
Just the creativity. So people have, you know, oh, I can't believe, you know, Pastor Mike in the church, you're just gimmicks, you know, and whatever. It's like... No, I call it being creative and relevant. Mm-hmm. Touching a segment of people who, they love their motorcycles, they're on the motorcycles, and truth to be told, you know, yeah, we bless the motorcycle, but we ask for God's anointing and blessing for the person.
Right.
So we bless the motorcycle, take just a second, but then we lay our hands on the drivers, mm-hmm. and then we pray for them. And oftentimes when people are coming through, they'll tell us, hey, I just found out I have cancer. Or could you pray for my aunt? Could you pray for my uncle? Could you pray for our kids? And they mention these prayer needs. And we get a chance to pray for people. Mm-hmm. We pray for over 1,700 people.
So cool.
I think that's creative.
Yeah, for sure.
Creative.
Well, and what that makes me think of, too, is, you know, a lot of this stuff just starts as a glimmer of an idea. You know, somebody has an idea of something that they maybe like to do. Explore that. You know, God may be in that.
In
you
that
just
thing
never know.
To do it.
I can remember you talking about driving down, you know, Main Street here in Forest Lake, you know, 4,000 years ago and seeing a bunch of teenagers in a parking lot enjoying their cars, but
yep,
frustrated because they kept getting run off by the cops, which was an appropriate behavior for the police. I mean, it was private property, blah, blah, blah. However, I loved that something clicked. And you recognized, oh, here's a way to connect with people. Here's a way to meet people. It just happens to be something that you really enjoy, too. And here we are all these years later. I don't know, we're 25 years, 26, 27 years, 29 years into an annual car show.
Yes.
And it's just grown into this wonderful thing that people wouldn't necessarily associate with your church does that. You know, way back. And so somebody out there might be thinking, I've got this idea and it feels even a bit cockamamie. Hey, man, go talk to somebody about it. God
yeah
might be in that as a bridge, as a way to get to know people.
Real often, your hobby is part of who you are. And when you are being you, great things can happen.
Mm-hmm.
Because God created you.
Right.
And so whatever that hobby is a great thing. So that story just reminds me. In fact, I'm going to pontificate.
There you go.
There's our $5 word today. Mm-hmm. I'm going to pontificate on that a little bit because that car show, it was very interesting. I remember I was driving Orlean's race car. So I built her a car, 55 two-door wagon that she drag raced at Brainerd. And I'm driving it through town to go to the grocery store. And I seen these kids. And I knew them, being car enthusiasts, and they enjoy their cars hanging around. So I stopped in to say hi to them, and a police officer went by, and like you said, they were going to be chased off, and I was like, really, why? Well, they don't let us be here and all that. And again, police were just doing their job.
Right.
But it gave me the idea of, you know, people, young people especially, they just want to be around together, hang around their cars, because the hoods are up, and they're all drooling on each other's, you know, mm-hmm, manifolds and mm-hmm looking at their cars. I thought, you know, we should do that at our church. And that was the beginning of the very first car show.
Mm-hmm.
And we named it Strut Your Stuff because at 16, you probably can't afford a whole lot, but you still love it. It's
mm-hmm
your car.
Right.
Strut your stuff.
Right.
You know, we didn't have any $100,000 cars back then.
Mm-hmm.
We do today.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's grown quite a bit. But I have a great story to tell of a miracle of salvation. And I'm going to start it now as we go up to our station break. But 2 weeks before that event, because we're going to have a tire burnout contest as a part of the car show,
mm-hmm,
because kids love to squeal their tires.
Mm-hmm.
They love to just light them up, and you know it's cool. So we were going to have that was going to be a part of it, and give a trophy away for the biggest, baddest burnout for motorcycle, car, and truck, and it was cool. So we are like 3 weeks out from the car show, got flyers made, and I'm at the old Flair, which you got to be a long-time Forest Lake person or old person to remember the Flair. But there's a bunch of police officers there, which, again, I knew these guys.
Is this a restaurant?
Yeah.
Okay.
It was a restaurant where Taco Bell is today.
Ah, gotcha. Okay.
Yes, right there on the corner of the freeway.
Mm-hmm.
So, and again, so I know these guys. So I go walking in, and they were harassing me about the car show because, you know, there's flyers around. They said, Pastor Mike, you know that you can't do a squealing your tires on your property. And that was the first I heard of it. I thought, what? I said, it's private property. You can do whatever you want out there. He says, nope, Forest Lake has an ordinance about squealing tires, even on private property. I was panicked, shocked, angry. I was all the range of emotions going, oh, Mike, are you kidding me? We've gotten that legislated and, you know, whatever else. And that was the anger part. Then it was, hey, we're 3 weeks out from this thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I advertised we're having a tire burnout contest. What in the world are we going to do?
Mm-hmm.
So I went back to the office. I called the city hall. I seen if I can get on the agenda for the next board meeting, city council meeting. And I could. They put me right up front, which was cool. I walk in. I said, hey, here's the deal. We have a car show coming, and we want to do a tire burnout. And all those city council members, I'll never forget, they looked at me like a deer in the headlights and a German shepherd cocking his head sideways trying to understand. They're all like, you want to do what? They're like, and it was almost like sane people would do that. Why would you want to do that? They just did not understand at all. They weren't car people.
Mm-hmm.
So I needed to explain to them the thoughts and the ideas of a motorhead. Horsepower can spin tires, which is cool. And the noise and the smoke that ensues is just added benefit. It's like frosting on the cake. It's like, woo, yeah, here we go. Little sidelight. When we first had the car show, we're doing the burnouts. I am not kidding, and I don't mean to make this a slam against anybody, but I had several women come to me every year saying, Mike, isn't that hard on the tires? I just think that's funny. Isn't that hard on the tires?
Well, for somebody out there wondering the answer to that question, what is it?
It's not hard on the tires. It helps round the tires and make them balanced so you get better gas mileage. It smooths everything out. Okay, if you believe that, I'm really sorry. I don't mean to be making fun of you, but no, of course it's hard on the tires. You're getting rid of rubber on the tire. But if you're a motorhead, you kind of don't care. It's just kind of cool.
You factor that into the budget.
You do. If you have one of the cars that will squeal tires, mm-hmm. you plan on buying more tires. Mm-hmm. So you're right. That's just part of the owning the car.
Mm-hmm.
Total cost of ownership. Just the way it is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so now tell the story. So I'm at city council, and they're looking at me. It's just so strange. You're going to do what? And they said, tell you what, we'll just give you a yes, a verbal yes, that you can do this. And if anybody complains, then the police will show up, and then you'll have to shut down. So if any of the neighbors complain or people complain about the noise or the smoke or whatever, you're going to have to stop doing it. And I said, okay, cool. So now I had a plan. I was going to make a bunch more of the car show flyers, and I was going to go introduce myself to all of our neighbors, knocking on every door, house after house. And this is the beginning of a very exciting story that I'm going to tell you right after this commercial break. You're listening to Something to Think About with me, Pastor Mike, a production of WAJC, Your Life Radio on 88.1 and 91.7 FM. We'd love to hear from you. If you have questions or comments about today's show, email us at waj@yourliferadio.com. If you're ever in the Forest Lake area, I'd love to personally invite you to join us for a Sunday morning service at 9:30 a.m. or Wednesday evenings at 6:30 p.m. There's something for everyone.
Something to Think About with Pastor Mike is a production of WAJC Your Life Radio, which is owned and operated by Maranatha Assembly of God in Forest Lake, Minnesota. You can find more information on the web at realchurch.org. Now, back to Something to Think About.
Hey, welcome back. So we're talking about creativity. At least I just used the springboard for that, but then you prompted me with this idea of, you know, the car show. It's a big deal at our church. We've been doing it for years and years and years, almost 30 years. And so I'm talking about the beginning of how it came. So when I was told by the city council that, yeah, you can do this as long as nobody complains. So made some flyers, and I'm going and I'm passing out neighbors. So I'm knocking on, you know, doors saying, hi, I'm you know, Pastor Mike. I pastor the church right here, and introducing myself and telling them that, hey, I just want you to know that this coming Saturday, we're going to have a car show and there's going to be a tire burnout contest. So it might get a little noisy. There might be some smoke. I just wanted to have you be prepared. So I wanted to just get a calm so people knew. Offered them free tickets to come to the show and all that. So I'm going through and I'm going to house after house after house. Well, then down the back road, I think it was Edgerton. Can't remember the name of it, but I think it was Edgerton. Anyway, so I'm going down and now I'm, you know, house, and there's like this long yards. Not like right behind the church was, you know, house on top of house on top of house. Now there was some property between them. So I went down the road quite a ways, and I'm halfway in this yard to this house. And it dawns on me as I'm looking back at how far the church is, looking where this house is, I'm thinking, this is far enough. I'm not going to go to this house because it's far enough away. I'm not worried about it creating a problem. So I'm in the middle of this yard. And I turn and I start walking back to the church. And the Lord stops me. and says, I want you to go to that house. So I literally stopped and kind of argued with, at the time, kind of like myself. I'm just like, yeah, I don't got to go there. That's too far away. It's not going to be a problem. And again, a strong sense of from the Lord saying, I want you to go to that house. And I remember feeling, I literally kind of sighed and kind of being kind of a pill, objecting to what God was trying to tell me to do, because it just didn't make sense. It's like, that's too far away. It didn't make sense. So it's like, why would God be telling me to do this? And so I'm wrestling with, and finally the feeling was so strong, I'm like, okay, I'll go to this house. So I turned, I start making my way across the yard, I go knock on this house. A young man comes to the door, and I wish I could describe the look on his face. His eyes were wide-eyed, a little crazy. He was stunned, shocked to see me. It was a weird emotion to be standing there with this guy from the door. He looked at me and he said, so I'm saying, you know, hey, I'm Pastor Mike. I pastor the church down the street here, and I just want you to know. He didn't hear a word I said. I'm just talking to him, and he looks at me and he says, can you come in? And I thought that was an odd request. So I sized him up and I looked at him and I thought, yeah, I can come in. Yeah, I don't think he's going to sexually abuse me. So I go in to the house. We're walking up the stairs and I look across the kitchen and there's a revolver sitting on the kitchen table. Now I'm paying attention. We walk in, we sit at that table, the pistol is right there. And he says to me, he said, I can't believe you're here. And I'm like, well, and I don't know how to answer him. I'm just like, yeah, you know, the car show. I said, I'm here. He said, no, you don't understand. He said, I was going to take my life. 2 minutes ago, I prayed. I said, God, if you're really real and if you love me, send someone to my house. That's what he said.
Wow.
Send someone to my house. Here I am, knocking on the door of his house, and he is shocked. We go in. He explains that he's going through a divorce and his life is miserable. He was, like I said, he was ready to end it. The revolver is right there. He prayed, God, if you love me, if you're real, send someone to my house.
Wow.
There I am. Make a long story short, I got a chance to explain the gospel message to him. He asked Christ into his life. And ironic, this story coming up right now is really interesting because just a month ago, I bumped into a woman who knows this guy, knows the story.
Wow.
And I asked, I said, how's he doing? She said, he's doing great. He leads a Bible study at church. He's been a Christian. He's been a strong Christian ever since.
Wow.
Which is just a glorious story.
Praise God. That's so awesome.
And it speaks to God's incredible, genuine care for people.
Yeah. No kidding.
So that, to me, was the highlight of that first car show, obviously. I mean, that's a story. You can't make this stuff up.
Right.
It was just really cool.
Wow. That's really neat.
So anyway, so we get to the car show, and my wife starts the car show off by doing the first burnout.
Fun.
It was really cool. Mm-hmm. And the crowd thought that was really cool because, you know, it's the pastor's wife, you know, a female doing a burnout in her pretty hot car. It is pretty cool. We also had a state trooper there.
Yeah.
He backed up on the burnout pad. I climbed in the car, had a microphone. So I'm talking to the crowd while I'm sitting in the squad. And I urged everybody to, you know, there's a time and a place for everything. This is the time. This is the place to do burnouts. Don't do it out there on the roads.
Right.
Don't give us a bad reputation, you know, for trying to encourage hooliganism. Is that a word we use anymore? Hooliganism? Did we ever use it? Being a hooligan? Something like that. Anyway, so I'm in there. I'm encouraging everybody. I said, hey, by the way, you can't outrun a radio. You know, with that, the trooper stepped on it. And, you know, it didn't do a burnout. It squealed the tires just a little bit as it left the pad. Just kind of, I found out that somebody complained.
About what?
Ruining public property.
Oh, you mean the vehicle?
That's right.
The police car.
I am so happy to see your dismay and wonderment.
I'm just shocked.
I mean, I was too. I'm like, are you serious?
Huh.
You know, there are some people out there. I'm glad we value uniqueness because there are some people out there that are very unique. I don't even know how you think that way. How you?
Right.
That was the greatest PR piece.
Oh my gosh.
You know, I heard he got reprimanded.
Wow.
Because it was a public display. Hey, they beat on their cars way harder than that day in and day out. This was a great PR piece. The crowd went wild, except for, of course, one person.
Well, and I think about, you know, I mean, we could, this is a whole different road to go down on, but, you know, it's our police community, the public safety, all of that stuff, working to have a great relationship with that community, with those people, and developing relationships, that's hugely beneficial to the whole community. So what that communicates to me is somebody is not keeping the main thing the main thing.
They really don't understand it.
Wow, that's too bad.
They live with their view right in front of their feet, just one little step after time. It's like, yeah, it's just ridiculous.
Mm. That's too bad.
Yeah, it's just too bad.
So creativity.
So I wrote a letter into the state, the headquarters, just to put another letter in his file instead of a reprimand, saying, "Hey, I just want you to know I was so thankful that a police or a state trooper was out there. He did great PR piece. More than I can't think of a better way to have more PR. All the motorheads thought that was the coolest thing in the world that a cop would be there with his car. And we've had police officers at our car show every year.
Yeah,
and we've had some police officers who are also hot rodders.
Yeah,
again, makes them human."
Right.
And with their hot rods there.
Right.
And it's just cool.
Yeah, that is
but
really cool.
But all of this discussion that we went down the road on this idea of being creative, just creative, doing something different. I know some people who are pool sharks.
Oh, yeah.
And they use that as a ministry tool.
Mm-hmm.
They hang out in pool halls and they're shooting pool. And when people realize how good they are, it gives them an open door to talk about Christ and the difference that Jesus has made in their life and being creative.
Right.
I wonder what things are not being done right now because people are sitting on an idea that they think is foolish or crazy.
Yeah. Well, I have an example in my life. You know, years ago, I learned how to knit. And enjoy.
Okay, that's crazy.
Yeah, enjoy knitting and all that other kind of stuff. It's actually great brain science. It keeps your brain young, like Sudoku. But anyway, we started up a Raiders of the Lost Arts group here. And once a month, the ladies would meet together, and it didn't matter to me what your lost art was. We could sit and knit and crochet, and you could tat if you wanted to. You could scrapbook or, you know, I mean, whatever it is you turned your crank, you know, in that department. Ladies, they came out. And it was just a lot of fun. And
this idea of fun.
Yeah.
Whenever you're doing something you enjoy, you're at your best. You're having fun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was fun.
So you ought to do it and invite others in with you.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
Yeah, it's really cool. Mm-hmm. So I remember we had a law enforcement. We have a lot of law enforcement in our church. They're great BS readers. And what they like here is because what they see, there's nobody playing games here. So we have a lot of police officers here. And we had one that was on the board. And even he at the beginning wasn't too sure about this whole idea of, you know, a car show, doing burnouts, encouraging that kind of hooliganism.
Mm-hmm.
There's that word again.
I'm telling you.
Yeah. But so he was standing with me out there that day, that morning, very first car show. We're standing out there. He's right there with me. And cars are starting to come up and show up. And he looked at me and says, "They're really going to come, aren't they?" I said, "Yep, they're really going to come." He said, and what are they going to do? I said, "They're going to sit around their cars and talk about cars and their car and how they built it and what it's got in it. And they're going to look at other people's cars. And they're going to do that all day." He said, "Really?" I said, "Yep."
Isn't that interesting?
I said, what do you like?" He said, "I like guns." I said, "We should have a gun show at church."
That's every time I show up. Boom, boom.
Oh, if our listeners could have saw that. Pastor Robin was doing the old biflex.
And everybody in the production booth is laughing because I don't exactly have, you know, well-developed
Biceps.
Biceps, but.
Yes, the old bicep curl.
Exactly.
Yes, yes. I love it when most women do that because there's more buy on the downside than there is on the upside.
You didn't have to go there.
I didn't have to
go there.
I think it's funny.
It's not National Batwing Day.
Batwing Day. Yeah. No, I just think that's funny. Sometimes I like to skate where angels fear to tread.
Well, be careful. I'm going to start talking about National Congenital Diaphragmatic Hernias again.
Yeah, it's really funny. I've heard you say it three times. I still don't even have a clue what it is.
Yeah.
I don't. I don't have a clue what that is. Is it something to do with your heart, cardio?
No. A diaphragm. Your diaphragm.
Okay,
diaphragm.
Yeah.
And a hernia there in that region. And that was congenital. It's like you're born with it. So you're born with it. Hernia right there by your diaphragm. There you go. You got all I got now.
Oh,
so
man.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if somebody's spinning the dial and they just land on this right now, they're spinning the dial, they hit that, they go, what in the world is crazy people on the radio? Can you believe that? There's crazy people on the radio. They actually let them talk on the radio. Oh, my gosh.
What are you going
to
do?
And that one guy, man, he's offensive to dog owners and to women with bat wings.
I know.
You know, I have to admit, I love the wonderful wrinkles in my wife's face. And some people say, oh, you can't talk about that. I'm like, why? We've earned them together.
Right.
I mean, we've been together since she was 15.
How old were you at the time?
17.
Oh, there you go. Okay.
So, I mean, we've just kind of grown old. We've been married. This May will be 44 years.
Oh, wow. Congratulations.
I know. Isn't that cool?
That's
44
very
years.
Exciting.
So in 44 years, you can accumulate a wrinkle or two.
You know, gravity's faithful.
It is.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, it pulled the hair right off my head. That's what gravity did. Pulled the hair right off my head.
I don't know. That's gravity.
Yeah, but no, I love those crow's feet. And I love the little wrinkles. It's like, I remember when they weren't there. And I saw them coming, and now they're there, and they're actually like terms of endearment.
Right.
I love them.
Things you guys share together.
Yeah. Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah. Very, very cool. Creative. Do we value anything else, Pastor Mike?
Well, you know, this idea of being creative, we do value that a lot.
We do.
And just to be creative, I mention again, I wonder what's out there residing in the hearts of people. And they just not thinking about it, like putting checkers matches together or chess matches or, mm-hmm. you know, video game night.
Right.
I just think there's a host of Esquirian horses.
You messed me up now, too. Equine.
Oh, blame?
Nope. It's, what is it? It's, gosh.
You're blaming me for messing you up, though.
You know, let me look it up.
Man,
I can do
what
that.
Is it? Esquirian,
I'm sure people are out there dying
horses.
Laughing.
Yeah, I know they're laughing because your horse people out
equestrian.
There are going, equestrian.
I knew we'd get it.
Yes. Only because you asked Siri.
I didn't even get to typing it in. I didn't.
Come on.
Yeah.
Okay, so there's a whole world right there, too.
Right, yes. Golfing
and
even frisbee
dogs
golf
and cats
or whatever.
God, you could do all kinds of things. One thing that at Maranatha we will never do is have the blessing of the pets day, though. We just won't do it.
Wow, you heard it here first.
Yeah, we just won't do it.
Okay.
God bless other churches that do it. I think it's fine if you do it. But again, this speaks to this idea of what's your thing. That's not my thing.
Mm-hmm.
What do we value? This world, we need to value one another.
Yeah, we do.
We really try hard. And again, we do our best. Mm-hmm. We try to value every person.
Mm-hmm.
Even people who we think are weird. And we know they think we're weird.
Mm-hmm.
Because everybody needs to realize, to the degree you think somebody is kind of off, they probably think the same thing about you. You know, we think that we're the center of the universe all the time. And we project all these judgments and how we perceive things. And we are the center of all of that. We are the center of all truth. Everybody is that way. So when you see somebody who's a couple degrees off from you, they can still be your friend. You tolerate them, whatever else. But you go a couple more degrees beyond that, and they're kind of weird. You try to avoid them. You go a couple more degrees off from that, you think they're really weird. You try to avoid them.
Hmm.
Well, real often, they think the same about you.
Mm-hmm. Hmm.
But to try to value one another, because Jesus said, all men will know that you're my disciples by your love one for another.
Mm-hmm.
And God, Lord, help us to love one another.
Right.
We need to be able to disagree.
Right. And that's one of the things, honestly, you know, life is typically faithful. People are typically faithful. If you wanted to find something off-putting about someone, chances are you can. I mean, we're all human. We all make mistakes, sometimes intentionally, sometimes not. But one of the things I try to focus on is there something good I can find? Because who do I want to be? How do I want to show up? Do I want to be that person? Because really, I mean, between me and the Lord, I'm going to have to answer for that too. And so, okay, what do I want to say? What do I want to be? How do I want to show up? How can I connect with them and value? Because you've mentioned before that there is a glimmer of the divine. There is the divine image in every person.
And that's where I go, because mm-hmm. we all are products of both genetics, but also our you know, nurture nature thing.
Right, exactly.
And so there's a reason why people are the way they are.
Yeah.
Whether it's horrible abuse,
right.
mistreatment,
mm-hmm.
unkind words,
mm-hmm.
bad experiences in life.
Taught to value
what
the wrong
they were
things.
Exactly. So mm-hmm. so they carry in this. There's a reason why people come to the place where they're at.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to see through that. Realize, number one, that happens.
Right.
They didn't just get there overnight. So that's prevalent. But also, then you got to look through all that and just realize the divine nature is in that person.
Right.
That God created them. God loves them as much as he loves you.
Amen.
As much.
And the hard part, I think, about that for most folks is when we hold expectation for them and they're not meeting that expectation. I expect you to behave like this. I expect you to function like this. And for whatever reason, whether it's a valid expectation or an invalid expectation, we're frustrated because our needs are not being met.
And that becomes the rub with how
I value you when you're not? And so that's...
And I think we should have the freedom to be able to say, you know, you're weird. I have the right and the freedom to think, you're weird.
True.
But that does not give me license to not like you.
Well,
or to not love you.
I think
not love you is probably a better difference. But I mean, this idea of, that doesn't mean that I can bully you.
Right.
I can disagree with you, and I can even say, you're weird.
Well, and I've heard you say, we're allowed our preferences.
Yes.
In the body of Christ, we're allowed our preferences. We are not allowed our prejudices.
Yep. That's true.
And so what does that look like? And just the course of an ordinary day when you're bumping up against somebody, it's great when you have affinity and you're enjoying it. There's just this whole sense of kumbaya. You know, folks might not even know what I mean by that out there these days. But when you're with somebody and they're just off-putting to you and offensive somehow or whatever, it is, that doesn't mean you don't address what needs to be addressed in
right.
a proper way.
Yeah, if it's wrong, if not, if it's just a preference. A preference,
exactly.
Well, you just got to realize, get over it.
Right.
Hey, I don't love animals the way a lot of other people love animals.
Right.
And it's like, ugh.
Right.
I just think that that's weird.
Right.
And when you come across people who you really think are weird, you got to realize, you know, some, it doesn't make them a bad person.
No.
Especially issues like that.
Right.
That doesn't mean they're a bad person. It's just,
right.
it's a preference. They do, you don't. Or they don't and you do. Whatever.
Right.
It does bring up the point, though, of just praying that when you get to heaven, they're not your roommate.
And all those mansions.
They're not in the mansion right next door.
Right.
Although, I have to admit, by then, and again, we say that tongue in cheek, because mm-hmm. in heaven, it's going to be so much different than we're not going to have any of the thoughts that we have today.
I wonder what unity will actually look like when we are totally and completely perfectly functioning in God's unity when we're in heaven.
Can't even comprehend.
No, because we live in this world right now. Mm-hmm.
I'm just like speechless.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just sitting here thinking about that. It's like, man, Lord, help us to get to the place where we can try to get that here on earth.
Right.
The way we love people.
Yep.
To be more patient, because Jesus taught us to pray, Lord, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Right.
You know, your will in heaven is that. So we're praying that we can try to model that out here on this earth.
Yeah.
To love people.
and very practically in the course of our ordinary lives. And it's okay. I honestly think it's really helpful to identify those things that we're different in so that you can look at them to set them in their proper place. Is that thing going to keep me from sharing the love of God within my heart with them? How big is the enemy? How big is the blockage that you're actually going to tolerate to keep you from loving people like God wants them loved?
He died for every single person, willing that none should perish, but that all would come to the knowledge of him.
Right.
And enjoy a wonderful, fruitful relationship with him.
Right.
Yes.
You know, you brought up something the other day that got my attention, and maybe one day we can talk about it, about Christians being superstitious, you know?
Oh, Christians are so superstitious. Oh, my gosh.
We can't have a potluck.
No. Yeah, we had to change the word to pot blessing.
That's
you
so
couldn't
weird.
Use the word pot. Christians are weird.
You know, we can be, you know.
It's a short trip to get there, you know? I mean, really. So when I talk about weird, it's like, yeah, we're weird. It's like, oh, my gosh. You know, I have felt like a square peg trying to go in a round hole my whole life. Mm-hmm. Just because I thought the church is just so weird, just bizarre.
Well, and I can tell you, just briefly, when I was 12, I went to my first what we would call a spirit-filled church. And I had never seen anything like that. You know, my mom was Catholic, my dad was Baptist, and here I am at this church with my best friend. We're in seventh grade.
Pentecostal church.
And so it was, I honestly was so uncomfortable, I didn't quite know what to do with it. But while I was uncomfortable, I was also filled with awe because I knew that I knew, and I don't even know how I knew, but I knew that God was here. And look how these people love him. And I don't know what they're doing. I want that, though.
Yeah.
I want that. And so it was so great that even though something might have been called weird associated with God through these people, I could still sense his love. I could still sense him wanting to know me. I could see him loving these people. And it intrigued me.
Well, it highlights another interesting point, and that is we label everything weird if it's outside of our realm of knowledge.
That's it.
You know, we are intimidated and we are afraid by what we don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that's just so human.
I can ride 150 miles an hour on a motorcycle, and it's cool. I can't ride a horse because I'm scared.
Oh, sure.
And again, it proves the idea that it's because I know nothing about horses.
Right.
They're just big, scary, powerful animals.
With their own mind.
I don't know them. I don't understand it. So it's scary.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we tend to make fun of things that we don't understand or things that we are not very good at.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, as we say goodbye pretty soon here, I want to just challenge all those of you who are listening to try to value the uniqueness that you see in others, realizing that they are put there sometimes maybe to make you a little more tolerant.
Hmm.
But also to realize that they are created in the image of God. No matter how weird or different somebody is, that they are made in the image of God, and we need to love one another. And we need to not be so thin-skinned, not to be irritated by every time somebody disagrees with us.
Mm-hmm.
It's just absolutely crazy. So we'll leave hoping that that we're not going to go off the rails on this crazy train today. It's like, woohoo, the crazy train. Man, oh, man, we started out just laughing our heads off, and now I'm getting wound up again. Let's get wound up, crank this train up so we can go off the rails on this crazy train. You all have a great day. See you next week.
Hey, thanks for tuning in today. Please join us right here each Friday morning at 8 a.m. If you have any questions or comments about today's show, email wajc@yourliferadio.com. You can hear more from Pastor Mike at Maranatha's website, realchurch.org, on the Messages and Media tab. The opinions expressed here are not necessarily those of the owner.
You may be an ambassador to England or France. You may like to gamble. You might like to dance. You may be the heavyweight champion of the world. You may be a socialite with a long string of pearls. But you're gonna have to serve somebody. Yes, indeed, you're gonna have to serve somebody. Well, it may be the
serve